has given me everything, and more than all, it has given me immense satisfaction.
There are huge good things which have happened in the last 60 years, but many bad things have happened.
Really, I'm proud of our country, and people from our country have earned great names in India and elsewhere.
We have taken to the villages by this Panchayat Raj Act only corruption and politics.
I dream of a great country, that my country will become a developed country by 2030.
India should encourage rural liberalization.
Wing Commander Arijit Ghosh. I have just retired from the Indian Air Force after spending 25 years with them. I've been a sportsman right from my childhood days and basically a cricketer. I started playing cricket at a very young age and continue to do so for almost 20-25 years, during which time I represented the state schools team and then graduated to the university team and the university zonal team, and then subsequently, of course, the state under 22 teams. And after joining the Indian Air Force, I played Ranji Trophy for the services team for almost 5 years. So with that background, I have been associated with sports in one way or the other for a very long time, over the last 25 years now. And I've seen a lot of sports events, I've been a part of a lot of sports teams, and where we have been dealing with sportsmen and the people associated with sports, the sports administrators. And in my last posting in the Indian Air Force, I was heading the Air Force Sports Board, which coordinated the sporting activities of almost 27 sports disciplines in the Indian Air Force. And we were in charge of making nodal centers for each sport and creating Air Force teams which played in the inter-services tournaments, and thereafter sportsmen went on to represent the services team playing in the nationals. And subsequently, some of them graduated to the Indian teams as well. A lot of services sportsmen have won medals at national and international levels as well. So it has been a pleasure to be associated very closely with such people, and having a little bit of a background myself as a sportsman, as a national level sportsman, it was easy to appreciate the various problems that one encounters as a sportsman, as an administrator in sports over this last few years. So it has been a fair amount of experience that I have collected over these years, and when I speak on the administering of sports, I speak with a perspective of having been a sportsman myself and also having administered sports over the last few years. Especially what I personally have always felt is that sports is best administered, best run by sportsmen themselves, because the sportsman has a particular kind of mental attitude which a common man who has never played sports perhaps would not actually be in a position to appreciate. The sportsman has a peculiar set of needs, a peculiar set of support that he requires from various quarters, which a non-sportsman would not probably be in a position to understand. So that, I feel, is the biggest shortcoming that we have in our country, in the sense that most of our organizations, most of our sporting organizations, are run by people who have not really been sportsmen at any level. And I'm not saying that you have to be a national level sportsman or an Indian team member to be able to run sports successfully. But it's very important that you should have played sports at some level. And you should have that attitude, that orientation towards sports to be able to understand the needs and the requirements that a sportsman has, the kind of motivation that he needs, the kind of support that he requires, the kind of emotional support in times of injury, in times of loss of form, when he's not doing well. Those are the times when a sportsman, more than anything, requires a lot of support to be able to come back to peak performance levels. So having said that, I would like to also add that we also lack a regulated sports structure in our country as on date, which builds up sportsmen from the grassroots level and brings them through various stages of training, various levels of performance, various kinds of various stages of sports, to the level of an elite athlete who would be competing at national and international levels.
आजा आजा जिंद शामी आने के तले है, आजा जरी और नीले आजमाने के तले है। आजा आजा जिंद शामी आने के तले है, आजा जरी और नीले।
And for that you require a dedicated grassroots program, which we don't have. We just don't have this grassroots program, youth development program in most of our sports disciplines in India. Perhaps to a certain extent, to a very large extent, cricket now already has this kind of setup in place, where a young cricketer, as young as maybe 12 years or 14 years of age, is recognized, is picked up and brought to training academies, where they get specialized training, specialized coaching, specialized diet, physiotherapists looking after them, building up their physical structure, looking at the various needs physically, technically, from the point of view of their diet, everything being coordinated. And slowly this child, who maybe joins at the age of 10 or 12, is taken through various stages until he graduates to become an elite athlete at the age of about 18 to 20 years of age. And the basic thing about creating an elite athlete is repetitively doing the various sports activities, that the various techniques of the activities that you need to do to become an elite athlete. So if you're talking about a cricketer, you need to, if you're a batsman, you need to learn the basics of batting first. You need to learn how to play a forward defensive shot and then maybe move on to the more attacking strokes, both on the front foot and the back foot. So all these things are basically repetitive in nature. You need to repeat those activities time and time and time and time again until you reach a level of perfection where you can do it with your eyes closed, even under extreme pressure in an international match or pressure situation. So that is the kind of time that you need to invest in the making of an international athlete. It is said that you need at least 10,000 repetitions of a particular skill to be able to master it and to be able to do it under pressure situations in a match environment. So that obviously means a lot of time the coaches, the administrators need a lot of time with the young sportsman to groom him to elite levels. So I personally feel that at least a period of 7 to 8 years minimum is required to make a sportsman reach elite levels from beginner status. Now, this is there, this system is already there in most of the developed countries as far as sports is concerned. But as I said, in our country it is still not really in place, except for maybe games like cricket, where you have the under the age group tournament starting from say under 14, under 16, under 17, and then you have something like the National Cricket Academy in place, where these selected children who have done well in their age group or respective age group tournaments go to, and they train under elite coaches and are exposed to nutritionists and dietitians and physiotherapists and other sports scientists who slowly build them up over a period of time. And these boys smoothly progress from one level, one age group to the other, till they reach elite levels. Now, this is not so in the other games. Maybe to a certain extent even football has started this now. But in the other games, I really don't see this kind of a initiative, this kind of a system in place. And which is why we don't have enough number of people achieving international medals for us, in spite of being such a large country.
ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಸಿಪಿ ಹಬೀಬ್ ರೆಹಮಾನ್ ಅವರ ಮುಖ್ಯಸ್ಥಿಕೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದ ಅಗ್ರಸ್ಥಾನದಲ್ಲಿರುವ ಆಸ್ಪತ್ರೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದಾಗಿದ್ದು, ಎಮರ್ಜೆನ್ಸಿ ಸರ್ವಿಸ್ಗೆ 1057707ಕ್ಕೆ ಕರೆ ಮಾಡಿ ಶೀಘ್ರ ಚಿಕಿತ್ಸೆಯನ್ನು ಪಡೆಯಬಹುದಾಗಿದೆ. ಯುನಿಟಿ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಕಾಂಪ್ಲೆಕ್ಸ್, ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟ್ ಲೈಫ್. ಆನ್ ISO 9001:2000 ಸರ್ಟಿಫೈಡ್ ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್, ಫಲ್ನಿ ರೋಡ್, ಮ್ಯಾಂಗಲೋರ್.
ಗುಹಾಂತರ, ಎ ನ್ಯೂ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಅಂಡರ್ ದಿ ಅರ್ಥ್, ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟೆಡ್ ವಿತ್ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಇಮ್ಯಾಜಿನೇಷನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟಿವಿಟಿ. A perfect cave living model with all modern amenities. Relax and to recreate. The first and largest cave resort in India, spread under 3 acres of land with playgrounds on top of it. Guhantara is beyond your imaginations. An ambience which existed 5,000 years ago, presented to you with modern facilities. Once you come in Guhantara, never goes out of your memory. Guhantara, Kanakpura Road, Bangalore.
India is my country. Where knowledge is free.
Where the world has not been.
Broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls.
Into that heaven of freedom, my father, let my country awake.
Well, it gives me quite a lot of pleasure to be part of this program just at a time when we have just celebrated 60-plus years of post-independence era. This country has been facing a lot of challenges in almost all sectors, and at a time when the entire global economy is opening up, and just around the time when the President of the United States of America has visited India, and new challenges this nation has and the whole world has to make this humanity a viable existence. Now, I would be speaking more on the sector related to agriculture, which has been contributing so heavily, providing employment for millions of people in this country. I must really impress upon you that this is a nation which has more than, say, 5 lakh villages, and about 60% of them are hugely dependent on agriculture as an occupation. And as you understand, this field of agriculture depends a lot on the natural factors, the rain, and also the quality of the soil that you have, and also various other environmental factors like humidity, like the sunshine and whatnot. I think it depends on number of factors. Apart from this, well, you have a nation which has got a huge population of almost a billion plus now. We are only second after China. And this huge country needs to be fed with very good quality food, because it is the quality of food that's very, very essential to build a good human resource. And that's how the nation till almost 60s was facing some problem with regard to providing food in adequate quantity to the population. But it is during the later years of the 60s, 1969 to be very precise, when we really started working on green revolution, using hybrid seeds, using the chemical fertilizers, and a new package of practices evolved by the University of Agricultural Sciences, really was a great effort from the Indian government in building the capacity of the people in adopting new technologies and improving the yields of agriculture. And that's how there was a considerable improvement in terms of the productivity of yields from the per unit area of land that the farmers were owning. But well, that did not suffice. Now, 30 years later from then, we see that, yes, yields definitely have improved after the application of fertilizers, with a better management of water, and also with proper spacing technologies, with proper management of pests, using chemicals, and all that have stabilized to the yields to certain level. They have stabilized the yields to certain level. But what we miss in the process is the qualitative aspects of food that really is very, very essential. You know, we are missing. In fact, I have a case where in a village where farmers are taking to production of gherkins, there is huge consumption of pesticide for this particular crop. This particular crop is being exported to the European countries. It is used as a pickle, and since this particular crop requires heavy dose of pesticides, these heavy dose of pesticides, when they are sprayed by the farmers who are cultivating these crops, what has happened is it has created health hazards. When we were looking at the way agriculture progress has taken place in this country from 1609 onwards, we have seen the extensive use of chemical fertilizers, we have used improved seeds, we have also used better water management practices like maybe sprinkler irrigation or drip irrigation, and maybe better package of practices evolved by the agricultural universities. Well, we achieved progress to certain extents in terms of meeting the food grain requirements and vegetable requirements of our country. But then it has not come at, it has come with certain costs. For example, the heavy consumption of pesticide has led to the residues into these agriculture commodities, and well, they have a lot of side effects that we see. And in most of the villages, we see lots of patients suffering from cancer, where especially in crops where like gherkins, they are this crop is not consumed in the country, but yet it is an export commodity where pickles are exported from a number of organizations, especially in the state of Karnataka. There are more than 27 companies which are in the export of gherkins. So what has happened is the excessive consumption of pesticides, indiscriminate use of pesticides, has led us to a level of disaster, which I must say, causing detriment to the health of the children, women, and as well as men. So this in turn is going to have a huge impact on the population. We are not going to have good quality population in the coming years. And you must understand the responsibility as a nation of this country, where we have more than 50% of the population less than 25 years old. Much of our younger generation doesn't know about the qualitative aspects of this food consumption. So this is perhaps in the coming years we will have not a very healthy population itself. So therefore, it is a very challenging situation at this country for the governments to governments to find out appropriate policy decisions. And well, indeed, there are certain states which have taken progressive steps, like the state of Karnataka, which has gone all out to popularize, promote the organic cultivation of crops, I must say. And well, there are quite a number of organizations which are working in these areas. Maybe private companies like Era Organic is working. Agriculture universities have developed new wings of departments which are closely working on organic farming practices. And there are individuals in their individual capacity promoting the natural farming, like Subhash Palekar. And many of the institutions like Art of Living promoting Rushi Krashi, these have been followed. There's tremendous contributions made in securing good quality food for the population. But anyway, I must say that Indian agriculture at this point of time is at crossroads, and huge effort is required from different sectors. Maybe I think the schools have to play a prominent role, the housewives associations have to play a prominent role, the organizations have to a prominent role, the universities and institutions have to play a more responsible role. More of the public institutions should mobilize opinion for going in for quality food, and the government has to positively respond by creating appropriate policy environment, so that level playing field is created for all of them, and there is churning out of better ideas in producing quality and healthy food for the millions in this country to consume. And that's, I think, the prime responsibility of the agriculture sector now. And at this point of time, I must say that not due respect is given to the use of water and also management of the soil. And these two areas, in fact, there are a couple of projects working, like Sujala, which has been supported by World Bank, and also Jala Samvardhana Yojana Sangha, which is working with the support of the World Bank funds. They have tried to a certain level in building the capacity of the farmers in understanding how important it is to manage water, how important it is to manage soil. Because if today you do not have water, if you do not know how to manage your soils, perhaps the entire agriculture of this nation is at stake.
ಕಾಂಪ್ಲೆಕ್ಸ್ ಡಾ ಸಿಪಿ ಹಬೀಬ್ ರೆಹಮಾನ್ ಅವರ ಮುಖ್ಯಸ್ಥಿಕೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದ ಅಗ್ರಸ್ಥಾನದಲ್ಲಿರುವ ಆಸ್ಪತ್ರೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದಾಗಿದ್ದು ಎಮರ್ಜೆನ್ಸಿ ಸರ್ವಿಸ್ಗೆ 1050707ಕ್ಕೆ ಕರೆ ಮಾಡಿ ಶೀಘ್ರ ಚಿಕಿತ್ಸೆಯನ್ನು ಪಡೆಯಬಹುದಾಗಿದೆ. ಯುನಿಟಿ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಕಾಂಪ್ಲೆಕ್ಸ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟ್ ಲೈಫ್ ಅಂಡ್ ISO 9001:2000 ಸರ್ಟಿಫೈಡ್ ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್ ಫಲ್ನಿ ರೋಡ್ ಮ್ಯಾಂಗಲೋರ್
ಗುಹಾಂತರ. A new world under the earth created with human imagination and creativity. A perfect cave living model with all modern amenities. Relax and to recreate. The first and largest cave resort in India, spread under 3 acres of land with playgrounds on top of it. Gohantara is beyond your imaginations. An ambience which existed 5,000 years ago, presented to you with modern facilities. Once you come in Gohantara, never goes out of your memory. Gohantara, Kanakpura Road, Bangalore.
India is my country. Where the world has not been, broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls.
Into that heaven of freedom, my father, let my country awake.
The other thing which is a part of this problem is that although we are a very large country, we have a huge population, but not all of them are playing sports. In fact, a very minuscule proportion of that population is actually playing sport, and serious sport for that matter. Maybe just about 2% or 3% of the population is actually has the access to these kind of sporting facilities where they can come up from beginner levels, from the initial levels to elite levels. Now this is something which actually negates the population that we have, because the final pool of talent from where you get to choose your sportsmen is actually very limited in our country. Maybe in a small country like say England, they have more people playing sport than in a country like India, which has such a vast population, because a very large portion of our population is not actually exposed to the kind of facilities, the kind of coaching and training and in sports infrastructure needed to create sportsmen. So actually speaking, even though our country is very large and we have a large population, there's a very small portion of it which is actually playing sport. And in those terms, we are actually smaller than small countries like England or Wales or name any of these European countries, where almost 100% of the population is exposed to the kind of sporting infrastructure that creates elite athletes or elite sportsmen. So that is another major problem. So we need to rope in more people to play sport, so that we have a larger talent pool available to us to select teams which would then go on to become the sportsmen who would represent the country at national and international levels. Now for that to happen, we again need what is known as a youth development program, starting from the grassroots level, where you have talent scouts going around all over the country. You have tournaments starting from as early as say under 8, under 10, under 12, and these talent scouts pick out the children who are performing well at these tournaments, get them to sporting academies where facilities are available, where the infrastructure is available, and then slowly you put them through various levels, various age groups, various different kinds of training programs until they reach the level where they can represent the country internationally. Now, these kind of programs are already in place in most of the developed countries. I can give an example of Switzerland where we took a school's football team in 2009. And we went to a football club called the Grasshopper Football Club, which had 20 football fields in their sports complex. And they had teams ranging from under 8 to under 20. They had age groups from under 8 to under 20. Then each of these teams of each age group had its own ground, had its own coach, had its own physio and the associated facilities. Apart from this, so obviously a child who joins that club at the age of 8, he moves on to under 9 the next year or under 10 or under 12 and finally he moves to the under 20 team, which is the semi-professional team. And then he becomes a full-fledged professional playing football in Europe. So that is the kind of system that we need to create footballers who would match up to the levels which we see in the World Cup or the European Cup and the English Premier League, etc. So all these footballers have been training with coaches, have been exposed to the best of sporting facilities for a period of almost 10 to 12 years. So the finished product that we see on television nowadays is one which has gone through rigorous training for 8, 10 or 12 years. Now, obviously, his skill levels, his fitness levels, his mental orientation towards the game would be a lot different from a person, from a sportsman, from a footballer in India who's probably just played for 1 or 2 years at that level or been exposed to those facilities for just 1 or 2 years. So that is something which we lack. This youth development program, starting from a very young age, building up to an international athlete or a sportsman, is something that we lack totally in India. That is just one aspect of it. Now, you can't create a sportsman in isolation. Now, if a small child comes to you, you have to give him schooling facilities as well so that there is an all-round development which takes place. In addition to his sports, in addition to his to the game that he plays, he also goes to school, he also progresses through his various classes, academics, so that when he finally graduates as a sportsman or as an individual also, he has had a holistic upbringing in the sense that he has had his education and he's also been exposed to the best of facilities and coaching in sports.
आजा जिंद शामी आने के तले हैं आजा जरी और नीले आजमाने के तले हैं जय हो जय हो आजा आजा जिंद शामी आने के तले हैं आजा जरी और
So that is something which again is very rarely available in our country and even if we have some coaching facilities available somewhere, we don't have schools associated with them where these children could be sent to and maybe groomed academically as well as in sports. So these things need to be coordinated in a youth development program where a young child is slowly taken through various stages of schooling and sports coaching simultaneously so that when he reaches an age of 18 or 20 years, he has had a balanced upbringing where he's also played sports, been exposed to the best of coaching and the best of facilities, and he's also done his education along the way. So those are the kind of things which are in place in most of these developed countries which we need to build up. The third thing that we need to inculcate in this youth development program is the availability of qualified coaches who actually need to be able to understand the needs of very young children as they go through through the development phases of their life, physically, mentally, emotionally, as they grow from an 8-year-old child to a 20-year-old man. Unfortunately, again, we have very few coaches who would be able to understand this kind of a psychology, as well as be able to impart the necessary coaching at different levels of physical development. So that professionalism also needs to come in to our coaches, where probably again we don't have enough people who are qualified to impart that kind of coaching. So all this club together, you need a coach who is also a mentor, sort of, who guides a young child of 8 years or 9 years or 10 years slowly over different age groups till he becomes an elite sportsman. And during that period, as I said, there would be a lot of development taking place in the child, physically, mentally, and as well as in his academics and other related spheres. So that kind of mental orientation, not many Indian coaches have, unfortunately. Plus, many of our coaches are still rooted in the old school of coaching, where when you come to the ground, you're told to run 10 laps of the ground first and then maybe, you know, get into your sporting activity. But the modern method of coaching is entirely different. You don't need to run 10 laps, because basically it all depends on what sport you're playing, what is the kind of physical effort that is required to play the sport that you're playing. So that your physical workouts, your physical activities need to be geared towards that specifically. So most of it is very scientifically planned, the physical development is looked after by the physiotherapists. They have strength and a movement assessment program which they carry out initially to decide what a child needs initially to develop into a top-notch sportsman. And thereafter, once having done that screening initially, they would take him through various exercises, through various kinds of training programs to ensure that he reaches that level of development. Similarly, the coaches, they have technical drills to teach various skills, where you actually do a skill repetitively time and time again till you master it. But the skill is broken down into different parts, small parts, and the young sportsman gets to learn the simpler parts first. Once he masters those simple aspects, then he graduates to the slightly more difficult parts of that skill. So this kind of scientific progression is something which is basically required amongst our coaches, which not many of them have at this stage. But as I said, in some games like cricket, football to a certain extent, tennis now, this kind of professionalism in the coaches is coming in slowly. Cricket, as I said, it's already in place because we have this National Cricket Academy at Bangalore, and we have a proper full-fledged coaching program in place right from the youngsters till the people who are playing for India. But in most other games, we don't have this kind of a developmental program in place, and we need it definitely in case if we are to produce international athletes who are going to win medals for us at various international competitions.